You're watching the free version of Silhouette Essentials. For projects and footage, head to borisfx.com for the premium download.
Before making more keyframes, let's go over some ways for editing shapes. The primary tools are Transform and Reshape, located at the top of the Roto toolbar on the left. If I click this top icon here, the Transform icon, and zoom in, I'll show you how to use this tool. You use the Transform tool either to edit entire shape or groups of shapes or groups of points using the on-screen controls or by moving the points on the edge of the Transform bounding box. I'll select the shape and you can see the bounding box around it. I can move this point up here and scale the shape. I can hold down Shift for a uniform scale. I can move this midpoint here and move the shape in and out. I can hold down the Alt key and shear the shape. I can also use the on-screen controls. The on-screen controls are Q, W, and E. Q for translate, W for rotate, and E for scale. If I click the Q key, you can see that, let me click on the shape here, I have the translate icon and I can move my shape around like that. If I click W, you can see I have a rotate icon and even a pivot point. So I'm going to pivot around that point to rotate. And if I click the E, you can see I have a scaling icon and I can scale from that pivot point as well. And to get out of the scaling or rotating or translating mode, you have to click the same key again. So I click E and I'm out of the scaling mode and I can move my pivot point around by just grabbing it with the arrow cursor. And to undo all these transformations, I can just use Command Z. And another way to move your shape as a whole, you can use the arrow keys as well. If I hold down the right arrow key, it moves to the right and to the left. If I hold down Shift, it moves 10 pixels. And then hold down Command, and that's some micro movement for less than 1 pixel, and those can be set in the preferences. So besides using Transform as a whole for the whole shape, you can actually also use it for points. And with this flyout menu here, you can do the point transform, but first I'm going to select some points. I'll select the Reshape tool and click a group of points down here. I can select them, and then if I press T, I'm in the Transform tool with the point, using the points mode. And now I can set my pivot point. I can just move that here. And if I press W for rotate, I'm rotating just that group of points. Ideally, you want to move your shape as a whole to keep it more consistent, but you can also resort to moving groups of points and then also points individually. If we take a look at the Reshape tool, I can click R and you can see we're selected on the Reshape tool here. And it has a little flyout menu with different options: Reshape, Magnetic Reshape, and Brush Reshape. In Reshape mode, you're just moving points individually, or you can select groups of points. If I select a point here, I can hold down the Shift key and select an endpoint there, and I have all the points selected. I can add to my selection by clicking another point and holding down the Shift key, and then I have all those selected. To click away and deselect the shape, I can just click off the shape itself. Another way to select all the points is to select the shape, hold down the Shift key, and click on one point. And then you can see all the points are selected. Next is the Magnetic Reshape. And we'll just click on the icon up here, and it toggles to the U, which is Magnetic Reshape. And here you can select a shape or a series of points and drag. And when I do that, you can see that it sort of moves them in a magnetic mode. Okay, and then there's also the Brush Reshape. And so you can see here I have a cursor and I can change the size of my brush cursor by clicking the bracket keys. So to increase it, to decrease it, you can see that my points become selected when they're under the radius of my brush. And then I can just move that out and move it back in. So it's a different kind of reshape, but it's really a good tool for when you want to move fast. You can just change the brush shape on the fly. So you're not dragging and clicking as much. You're just sort of selecting the points that you need and moving them into place. And we'll do this more when we start the keyframing process. Let's talk a bit about keyframing while I show my process. Keyframing is the process of animating an object over time and position. When manually keyframing, which is what we will do here, I will try to place keyframes at the peak of each movement in space. Silhouette will then interpolate the movement between those keyframes. The artist should analyze the object to evaluate what might be necessary and judge the amount of camera movement, shape movement, and their interplay. After those keyframes are done, I will go in between and make more keyframes as needed, otherwise known as tweening. While tracking can automate the keyframing process, and we will explore that later, it's important to understand manual keyframing methodology. One wants to make as few keyframes as possible, but also keep in mind that too few keyframes may result in drifting or bouncing, and too many will cause jittering or chattering. For shapes that have an even and linear movement, one can make keyframes at regular intervals, like 8s or 10s, and then decrease the intervals as necessary. Keyframes are indicated in the timeline window below the viewer and also with markers on the time bar. Use the hotkey Shift Z to go to the previous keyframe and Shift X to go to the next keyframe. Our keyframes are done, and there are various options to see the work and evaluate it. There are four viewing options in the pull-down menu, and currently we are on output. But if we select Color Comp or press 4 on the keyboard, we see our object over gray and then press the hotkey 1 to return to the output view. To view a shape's alpha channel, make sure you are on output and select the A key to cycle through the three modes. First to see the alpha channel over the image, and then click A again to see the alpha channel over black, and then click A once again to return to the color image. To make the rotoscoping process fast, try rotoing in foreground mode in the viewer for the roto node. One can roto fast while no other process is going on. This is good if you are checking shapes regularly for motion blur accuracy. If you are in foreground mode but want to check your work, a quick way to do that is to click Shift A, which will toggle the view to the output, superimpose the alpha channel over the image, and deactivate the overlay, which would be the roto shape outlines. Then click Shift A again to return the viewer to its previous state. A cool hotkey here is the semicolon, and when one is in any of these overlay states, you can click the semicolon key and it inverts the alpha channel. You can see what modes you're in by looking at the channel viewer, and on the right, the alpha color is indicated. The opacity of the overlay can be edited here on the top of the viewer, as well as its color, which is in the color preferences here.